Lucky you.
36 best holes in golf.
Alternate Shots Podcast.
Barney's Army.
Where we talk about golf.
Sandy.
Poker.
James Bond.
Horse racing.
Double.
Classic movies.
Zenyatta.
We have no script.
Down the stretch they come.
We are glad you joined us.
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
So you wouldn't care. You wouldn't care if all your members threw a few puffs down them.
No, they would go get them.
So your dad and you, what do you feel it in your legs?
I feel it in my. I went to my right leg, and now if I got through this head, like this head was gonna come off, I'm gonna throw this club head. I'm gonna throw this club.
So Billy, we are thrilled to have today's special guest, Mike Burke. Son of the famous Jackie Burke Jr., who we're looking at here. We'll talk about that in a moment. He was a longtime assistant pro with Claude Harmon, and he worked with Mo Della Porta. Billy, what do you got to say about this?
I picked up some good tips about how to throw my club. That's unbelievable. You were basically given permission by your dad to throw golf clubs. That must have been awesome.
All the time. He was pretty good at throwing them, too. He had a temper when he was younger as a pro. But in this video clip, his father taught him this lesson, because he used to sit when my grandfather, Jack Burke Sr., was giving lessons. He would sit there by him and listen to all of his lessons. And one of the lessons he was trying to teach the gentleman was how to release and let it go and make a swing that they didn't hold on to the grip handle. And they would let the club go through, and he used his legs, and he showed them how to use their feet. So he was very athletic swinger, and my dad was a very natural player, and his grandfather taught at River Oaks from 1922 to 1946, and when he passed. So my dad learned literally sitting by Jack Burke Sr. at River Oaks Country Club. And the other thing that's important is Jack Burke Sr., assistant pro at the pro shop at River Oaks, was Jimmy Demaret.
Wow. Was that also in Houston?
Yes, they were both. My dad was a youngster coming up, and Jimmy Demaret was my grandfather's assistant. And he worked at River Oaks with my grandfather, Jack Burke Sr. And that's how my dad met Jimmy Demaret. He was 10 years older than my father, and he was his mentor in life.
Who was it that they ventured down to Texas to bring golf to Texas? Because it wasn't big in Texas. It must have been your grandfather.
Yes.
Your grandfather, Jack Burke Sr.?
Yes, he was from Philadelphia. There was a lot of oil money in Houston, obviously, at the time in 1922. And they started River Oaks Country Club. And they brought Jack Burke Sr. in order to start River Oaks Country Club. He was a very good player. He has an unbelievable track record. He's won several tournaments in his sections, but he was mostly a teacher, and that's what his job was. He was brought in to Houston to start River Oaks Country Club, and he was the first pro there, and he stayed until he died in the war. My dad was 21, and he was in San Diego in the Marines, and he passed, and he had to come back. So we've been in the golf business in Houston for 100 years.
That's amazing. And you brought it to Houston, and you're
right.
Think of all the people, wasn't so many people, University of Houston golfers, how many people, you know, Billy Harmon talks about the Harmon tree. You got the Burke tree.
So it was in River Oaks was an interesting back then. It was, I don't say it was the Wild West, but it was close. And so my dad would always go out to the club. He'd go with my grandfather every day. And my grandfather would give a lesson. And so he'd say, little Jackie, you go play. And so he would play with Babe Dietrichson Zaharias all the time, because she took lessons from my grandfather. And Howard Hughes was a member there. And they would always say, oh, Jackie, go play with Howard Hughes. And Howard Hughes played in tennis shoes, and they called him Tennis Hughes. And he turned out to be Howard Hughes. It was amazing. And Harvey Pennick came there all the time. He was there a lot. So there was a lot of older pros that revered my grandfather, and he was a really good teacher. And so they would come to the River Oaks, and then they'd go after to the house for dinner, and my dad would sit around the table listening to all their conversations.
Well, Billy has a relationship, but something like that with Howard Hughes. Was it your
my uncle?
Yeah,
my uncle bought all those films from him and started a million-dollar movie.
So there was a lot of really good players come through the city, and my grandfather Jack Burke Sr. played the first round of golf at Memorial Park, which is now the site of the Houston Open in 1922. And during the war, you know, they all left to go to Mr. Demaret. My dad all went to the war. And then when they passed, he came back. When Jack Burke Sr. passed, he had 8 children. My dad was the oldest.
Golf swing, and the only thing missing is the golf club.
That's right.
But look at that perfect finish. And you wouldn't have known, instead of hitting a ball, he threw the club. So it was no different if he was hitting a ball or if he's throwing the club, and he was trying to teach the release, right?
Yes. And also remember, back then it was a wooden shafted club and there were different flexes. So he was trying to get them to release. You know, the shafts now are more adaptable to a release. But back then it was a wooden shaft. So they were holding, and he just, with leather grips, he just said, look, you gotta rotate. You got to use your feet. You got to use your body. It's a use your whole core. So he's a very natural teacher. He just talks to you. He doesn't draw lines and he doesn't use video. So the example in this video was, he always imagined that there was he took a shaft and he put took a mud ball and stuck it on the end of the shaft. And you had to swing it in order for the ball not to come off before you get to the impact. He wanted you to learn to hold and then release and let it go after the strike. So he loves to teach using analogies and just, you know, other things. He'll talk to you is more than he'll show you. He's a really good teacher, but he talks to you, and he can talk you through a swing where other people are giving you places to put your hands and all these kind of technical lessons. He's not that way at all. He's a natural player and he's a field player. And that's what, and he's an adaptive player.
I like that approach.
Yeah. So if it's cold, he swings different. If it's hot, it doesn't, you know. And then he's always talking about the lie. They say, well, how far? He said, I don't know how far it is till I get down there and what club to hit, till I see the lie and the conditions and what I'm aiming at.
That's right.
He didn't have a formula. He just looked at everything and he said, this is what is required of the shot. So he visualized his shot, visualized it, and then he just executed the ball flight he needed to get the job done.
Sort of the way baseball players used to hit balls before analytics and launch angles and everything interrupted the whole.
He's a very natural, reactive golfer. I know that if his swing wasn't working, he'd change it on the spot.
He played at the highest level.
Yes.
What did he learn the game by playing, or did he learn the game, then taught, and then became a player? Because they see in the 40s and 50s, he and Demaret were pretty dominant, along with obviously Hogan and Snead. But he had pretty good competition, yet still won 2 majors. He won the 56 Masters and the 56 PGA maybe 2 months apart. I mean, how good was your father? He had to be the best in the game at that point.
Yes, and he also won 4 tournaments in a row. Not 4 tournaments, you know, that he played in, but 4, like, that whole month, he won every tournament he played in 1952.
How old were you at that time, Mike?
Well, I was born in 54, so I'm 68, and so he won those before I was born. Yeah. But he won $8,000, and he won every tournament in the whole month.
$8,000.
How do you make that much in a month?
Yeah, I would say that to answer your question directly, he learned how to play from his father. That's how he learned to play golf. And they would just send him out on the course and make him play. Back then, people didn't practice. There was no really place to practice. So he played a lot. He played all the time, and he played many rounds. And he also played with older, when he was young, he played with a lot of older gentlemen. And that's how he got good, because he was young and he played with an older gentleman at River Oaks. And then there was a lot of good players in Houston and comes through there that see my grandfather. So he really learned to play from his father. And then, of course, the other teachers that came, Johnny Revolta and Pennick, all were mentored by Jack Burke Sr. Jack Burke Sr. is the key to the whole thing, really. He was an amazing, I wish I had met him, but I didn't. But he was an amazing man.
So you could compare the way your dad taught the game of golf, much like the way Harvey Pennick taught the game of golf.
Yes.
In a simple fashion, right?
Yes. They're very common. They use common sense. And the other thing I think my dad's really biggest, I think he admired the most was Ben Hogan. And Ben Hogan had a tremendous relationship with Jimmy Demaret. They were very close friends. And so Mr. Demaret was a totally different golfer than my father. When he was at the pro shop at River Oaks, my grandfather was teaching. And at the end of the day, they bring all the clubs into the bag room, and Mr. Demerit's job was to clean them. And back then it was carbon steel, and you had to buff the irons with a buffer to get the rust off of them and put them back in the bag. So he would stand in front of the buffer and hold that iron, and he would buff those irons, and he had to stand there, and he got pie arms, and he had a really narrow stance, hold those carbon steel iron, and he'd clean them all and put them up. He was a very strong man, and his legs were strong, and he could stand and play golf with a very narrow stance. He never practiced. He had an old wooden club, and he took the sole plate off and filled it full of lead. And then he put the sole plate back on it, and that's what he swung, was a heavy club. He swung a heavy club before anybody ever knew what they were.
Yeah, he created that heavy club. Claude Harmon might have created with Mo Della Porta, and maybe the lob wedge, because the year that Claude played in the Open at Wingfoot in 59, he got it up and down every single time. But before the Open, he went back in the shop and Mo bent it.
So my grandfather invented the cord line grip. Basically, he was traveling and he had a flat tire. And so he looked at, pulled over, looked at the tire, and he looked inside that two-ply tire, and there was a cords all inside that tire. And he grabbed that rubber and he said, wow, this would be a good way to put a grip on a golf club, because it's textured. And so they went back and they figured it out. And that's the first cord line grip was Jack Burke Sr. invented it. He did not renew the patent, unfortunately, or I'd be talking to you. We'd be talking to you from a different location.
High in the sky in a private jet.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he was an interesting, I wish I had met him. And I met a lot of the members from River Oaks that later joined Champions. They would come out to Champions and they knew my grandfather, and I would sit with them and they would tell me a lot about him.
We're talking about Jimmy Demaret, and I know he's a big impression on you and your father and your life. And one of the greatest bits I think Billy and I have ever seen is this bit with Jimmy Demaret on the Lucy Show.
A lot of people don't realize that Jimmy Demaret learned a lot about golf from Lucy. There was a lot of things he didn't understand about how to address the ball. She's giving him tips about how to address the ball and even before standing up to it, how to approach the shot. Not many people could do it that way, but Jimmy Demaret figured out how with a lot of help from Lucille Ball.
Yeah, some people learned the Varden grip, the interlock, the overlap, Jimmy Demaret learned from I Love Lucy the hop, skip, and a jump drive.
Which was later mimicked by, or on some level, by Adam Sandler. And
I just love that video. And
all kidding aside, Jimmy Demaret was one of the big-time guys in golf, and your family had a good relationship with him, Mike?
Yes, he worked for my grandfather, obviously, Jack Burke Sr. at River Oaks Country Club. And then, when the war was over, everybody got jobs up east, and Mr. Demaret was instrumental in getting my dad, you know, to go with him. They just took him under his wing, and he really, you know, as my dad was a young man, Mr. Demaret would babysit all the kids while Jack Burke Sr. and my grandmother, Mimi, would go out to dinner. Demaret would work all day at the pro shop, and then he'd have to go over to the Burke house and babysit all those knuckleheads. And so after he got on tour, he told my dad, he said, "I didn't know I'd be babysitting you for 70 years. So that's what he actually, they were like family, really. And the Demaret family and the Burke family are like family. And I feel that way about Mr. Demaret because my dad kept playing on the tour when Mr. Demaret had retired from the tour. So he had to babysit us. And he said, "Man, I've been babysitting you Burks for too long." So when my dad was on tour at Champions, we'd go out to the club and Mr. Demaret would have to take care of me and my brother and all of us little kids. And so he really was a mentor to my father, and he's also a mentor to me and my brother and all of us kids around there at the club. He was very playful and he had a wonderful sense of humor. He was very funny. And but he was a very happy person. When you saw him on the golf course, he was never angry or brooding or that. He was just a very fun, loving person to be around. And he was very nice to the young people. He would play golf with us. We'd be out there playing, a bunch of us little kids, and he'd come out and join us and just play golf with us.
Not many guys were like that. I saw some of the older guys in the 74 Open, you know, J.C. Snead. He was no fun. Two things that come to mind. Well, Jimmy Demaret didn't need to go to a health club. That buffing those irons. Now I know why in Moe's shop he had all those buffers. I just think that was for something else. But, you know, it does occur to me that back in the late 60s, early 70s, clubs did get rusty. So they were made of that material. So that's what they had to put in, right? That's I never thought of that. I just thought.
And he had a really, really narrow stance because he had to stay, you know, and his balance was to hold that club on that buffer. And he had a wonderful swing and his hands were real strong and he didn't make a big, like my dad had a bigger shoulder, more core, but Mr. Demaret had a really short little swing and he hit it dead straight every time. And that's why Ben Hogan always picked him to play in the match play events because Demaret was such a good driver of the golf ball. And Mr. Demaret was, I think Mr. Hogan admired him greatly. And they spoke all the time on the phone and talked a lot. They were very friendly. And Jimmy Demaret and Ben Hogan and my dad were very close. When they had the Houston Open at Champions, Mr. Demaret would bring in Ben Hogan early and he would practice for like 2 weeks. And there was, you know, he was playing the Houston Open when he was in his 50s. So there was he would go over to the Jackrabbit course and practice. He liked to practice into the wind on the golf course. So he was practicing over there on 14 on Jackrabbit, hitting it into the prevailing wind. And all these other young pros are at the Houston Open. Jimmy, how come Ben Hogan can go over there and practice on the golf course? We can't go over there and practice. And Demaret looked at him. He said, "Son, when you win 9 majors, you can practice over there too."
Yeah. Well, it's kind of, that's the other question that came to my head is they were two different types of personalities, Ben Hogan and Demaret, and maybe that's why it worked.
Well, I spent a lot of time with Mr. Hogan. We were very fortunate to have, you know, when he came, we were on the driving range driving everybody crazy, and we get to shag balls for him. We'd pick them up. Back then they didn't, you know, you just took them out and they hit you. And you knew he changed clubs when the ball went over your head about 8 yards and you just moved the bag. And we'd come in and I would sit and watch him practice. I've caddied for him. We played golf with him. And he was the nicest man. He had the best manners. He was very well dressed. And the thing I remember about him is he always had a money clip on him and he always had new money. His money was clean, just like his shoes and he was very nice, very polite, and he had a good sense of humor. Now, people talk about Ben Hogan. He was the opposite of the way he was on the golf course. When he was on the golf course, it was all business. But when he's off the golf course, he was very, very nice, very polite. He was nice to a lot of people, talked to the caddies. He was just a nice man. He was very quiet, but he was, and he had a great sense of humor, and Jimmy Demaret could make him laugh. And that's why they got along so well. He was very nice to us as little kids too.
Was Hogan good friends with Snead as well?
You know, I don't know that I would say that.
I know.
I don't know. We never saw Sam Snead. We saw a lot of Mr. Hogan. Yeah. He was good friends. He was good friends with, like, my dad's buddies was Mike Suchek, Jay Hebert. Those are the guys. And Miller Barber was really close to my dad. And my dad would give him lessons all the time. And his nickname was Peaches. Huh. But his name in the public was Mr. X.
Why'd they call him Peaches?
That was just his nickname. He was from Northeast Texas, and that's just his name. They just called him Peaches. We had an opportunity because of Champions to see all the pros come through. Every single pro that probably won a major after the war through the early 80s and, you know, when we had the tournament there, came through Champions to see Mr. Demaret.
When you shagged for Ben Hogan, or as you say, Mr. Hogan, how many times did he hit you? Not on purpose. He was just going at the target. You were the target.
You put the bag down, and then you just stand behind it, and he would hit it right at the bag. And you wouldn't have to walk more than 2 or 3 feet to pick the ball up.
Ever put any – did he ever fly any in the bag?
No, he could get really close. I mean, like every one of them, with a driver too. I mean, it wasn't just a wedge. He was, like, very precise. And then he would wave you in. They'd bring the balls. You'd drop them, and then he'd send you back out.
I know he had clubs. I don't know if he always had his own clubs before, but did he use – what balls did he use? Did he have Hogan balls manufactured at that time, or was he using some other ball?
I think back then they were – a lot of them were on staff. Like, my dad was with McGregor, and Jimmy Demaret with Top Flight. So they all had their own staff ball back then, and you could play. But I'll tell you how nice a man he is. So when we were little kids, he would come early to the Houston Open and practice. And so on Monday, we could play golf. It's like I could play with all my little buddies from the locker room, like the locker room attendants' sons and sons of the employees. We could all play on Monday. And my dad and Jimmy Demaret and Ben Hogan were playing on Cyprus, getting ready for the Houston Open. And number 7 goes south and number 2 goes north. And all of us were on number 2 on Cypress Creek getting ready to hit. And they were going down number 7, and they saw us over on number 2. And my dad walks over and brings Ben Hogan and Jimmy Demaret and says, "All right, boys, we want to watch y'all hit." And I said, "Dad, I'm not going to hit in front of Ben Hogan. Are you kidding me?" And everybody else is, you know, "No, we're not going to hit." He goes, "No, you need to hit." I said, "Well, we've been working on our clubs. They're not in good shape, and they're kind of bad." He said, "Hit." So we all got up there, hit a little old shot, and we were complaining, you know, our clubs weren't the best, blah, 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 blah. Ben Hogan didn't say one word. He just watched us hit. So they go play number 7, and we go down number 2. He plays in the Houston Open. I think he finished in the top 10. He played really good for somebody before the senior tour started. In about, I'd say 6 weeks or 8 weeks after that, my Uncle Jimmy was the pro at Champions, called us in and said, "I got something for you." I said, "I thought I was in trouble. I'm always getting called in for something." And I go in the pro shop, and there's 5 boxes on the wall. He said, "That's your box." I said, "What?" Ben Hogan Golf Company. He had sent every single one of the kids that we teed off a new set of clubs. And okay, I opened up the box. I had a brand new set of Hogan Woods, irons, bag, putter, wedges, everything. And each kid that we played with got a new set of clubs from Mr. Hogan, because we were embarrassed because we had a bunch of ragtag set of clubs as a little kid. But that's how thoughtful of a man he was, that he cared enough about, you know, 5 little kids playing golf, that he sent them all a set of clubs. No one knows how kind he was. No one.
How old were you back then, Mike, when that
I was probably 12. Maybe 12.
Your eyes must have lit up.
Oh my gosh. We went and played that day right then.
You played until it was dark.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think there was a side to Ben Hogan that a lot of people didn't see. He was a very, very giving man. Very.
If you look back and you went back and you brought the balls in and maybe you cleaned off his clubs for him after you shagged for him, you ever take a close look at the iron he was hitting and see the little, how small was the mark that he made?
It's right in the middle of the club. Right in the middle.
No bigger than a dime, maybe half of a dime.
It was right in the middle.
Unbelievable, right?
And the gentleman that ran our bag room was named Booker Brown, and that was Mr. Hogan's club repairman, and he would bring in all of his woods and wrap them because he would change shafts all the time. And so the whipping around those wooden shafts was very difficult to do, and Booker was this big, strong guy, and he could really get the whipping tight, and that's what Ben Hogan liked. Plus, when he changed grips, he took the coat hangers, he took the middle of the coat hanger out, and he cut it. And then he took that middle coat and he taped it on the inside of the grip before he put the rubber grip on. He taped it to where he had a weak grip, and it was not on the center of the bias of the shaft. It was a little over to the right. And so when he gripped the club, he had a weak, it made him have a weak grip, and he never hit a hook. And I watched him build those grips many a day. And there was a little reminder in the back of the grip that kept him, his grip where he wanted it.
I wonder how many times he'd have to go get new clubs by wearing them out. And grips, he must have worn them out weekly.
Yeah, he could, and he didn't wear a glove. So it was interesting. I don't know how often he changed clubs. We would see him for the Houston Open. And then, of course, he was the captain of the Ryder Cup team at Champions in 1967. So we saw him for a long time that week.
Go back to what how this came about, Jimmy Demaret and your dad founding Champions back in 1957, which probably was like climbing Mount Everest, right? That was
correct.
A big deal.
Houston was growing, and so Mr. Demaret, my dad, there was really no money in pro golf. I mean, they didn't even pay. If you didn't finish in the top 10, a lot of times you didn't get paid. So they were looking for a way to get off the tour and make a living. And they built Champions as a way to do that. And that was way back in the 50s. And they knew the airport was going to move from the south side of Houston to the north side. So they went and looked at property out on the north side of town on a road called 1960. And they bought 650 acres. And Ralph Plummer came and they built Champions Golf Club. And the gentleman that named Champions is Jack Valente. Jack Valente was a promoter. He was a PR guy here in Houston, and later he went on to run Motion Picture.
Oh, yeah.
So they said, what are you going to call it? He goes, well, I got two champions here. He said, let's just call it Champions Golf Club. And that's how they named it. And that was Jack Valente's idea. My dad and Mr. Demaret agreed, and that's how it started.
Comes back to movies, Billy.
Always does.
The thing about Mr. Demaret that I think is really interesting is that he was a very talented, he could sing. He was a really good singer, and he was really good friends with Bing Crosby and Phil Harris, and all the Hollywood guys loved him. He was really funny, and he could sing like crazy, and he was a pilot, and he had several airplanes. So he was an amazing human being and he played golf for fun almost. But he also started the tour, the big tour, before the big tour started. Mr. Demaret played, and then finally they organized from a wintertime event. Then it would pay him a year round. So he really started the big tour with Gene Sarazen and the fellas, and he played, won three Masters and the majors and all that. And then later, he was the first television commentator with Gene Sarazen on the Shell's Wonderful World of Golf. And he had coined a lot of phrases, like he was real funny and the guy hit it up on the green. He goes, where'd he hit it? He goes, oh, he hit it on the frog hair right by this. So he coined the word frog hair. So he started the big tour, or is one of the organizers of the big tour. He became the first really television commentator for golf with Shell's Wonderful World of Golf. And the gentleman that ran Shell's Wonderful Golf was named Fred Rayfield. And Fred came and said, and like, I think it was like 1979, he didn't have anything to do. And he was sitting in Mr. Demaret. He said, we need something to do. Let's start a tournament. So they said, all right, Demaret had a ownership in Onion Creek in Austin. He said, I'll do a tournament provided we do it at Onion Creek. And Fred Rayfield said, good. And that was the Liberty Mutual Legends of Golf first senior event. It was a team event. And that's where the senior golf tour started. And that's Fred Rayfield was the producer. So Demaret, if you think about it, he started the big tour as organized, became the first real television commentator, and he started the senior tour. He was an unbelievable person. I spent a lot of time with him.
Great personality for it. You could see it on that clip with on the Lucy show. He just had a great charm. He must have had tremendous charisma, kind of like in the league of Palmer, Arnold Palmer charisma.
He was famous before people were famous. The Hollywood people loved him. He was like the man. But the best story for Demaret in my life was, I was at University of Houston playing on the golf team, and it was a Monday, and I played, you know, I was going to play between my freshman and sophomore year. I played Cypress, and I played them that first nine. I played really good, you know, nine holes, and I shot like one under. And so I was playing good. I walked in the clubhouse. There's nobody in there. I walked in. There's Demaret at his desk. And he's sitting there and he's opening in his mail and he's not talking. And he's opening his mail and I'm telling him about my round. I said, oh man, you should have seen my drive on one, number two, number three, birdie. And then, you know, I lipped out and then I get around and I birdie eight and then 34. And I said, God, I might have been playing so good. I said, I think I'm just going to turn pro. I'm going to get, what the heck with the University of Houston? I'm just going to turn pro. And so he's opening the mail. He ain't listening to anything I'm saying until I said that. And he was pulling checks out of, like, I remember this. He was pulling a check out. It was an I Love Lucy residual check, royalty check. So he's taking checks out of envelopes. And I'm telling him about my stupid little nine-hole score. And he goes, what did you say? I said, Mr. Demaret, you heard that nine holes. I'm going to turn pro. He goes, whoa. Hold on a minute. He said, you know how I turned pro? I said, no, how did you turn pro? He goes, well, I played at River Oaks. I couldn't find anybody that could beat me. I went over to Braeburn. I couldn't find anybody that could beat me. I went over to Memorial Park. I couldn't find anybody that beat me. He said, I couldn't find anybody that could beat me in Houston. And I had to leave town. He said, now, since you've been telling me about your little nine-hole match, three people walk by this office that can beat you. Don't turn pro. He said, go finish your education and stay an amateur. So I would, you know, he told me, he said, you know, unless you can beat everybody in town, don't leave town and don't turn pro. So I followed his advice and I went and finished my education at University of Houston and got a job in Wall Street. And, you know, that was 3 years or 4 years later. The phone rings in the office and this lady's answering the phone and she goes, Mike, you're the new guy. And there's somebody on the phone named Mr. Demaret calling you. Of course, everybody in my office was golfers. And they said, oh, Jimmy Demaret's calling Mike. What's there? And he called me. He said, Mike, what you doing? I said, I'm working. He goes, I just want to tell you, I really admire you for finishing your education. And I'm very proud of you. And he said, I'm just calling to tell you, I appreciate you, you know, taking my advice and not turning pro when thought you could really play. And I said, well, thank you, Mr. Demaret. And he said, what are you doing? And I told him, he goes, well, when you figure out what you're doing, call me, I'll send you some money. And I was a Wall Street broker at the time. So he remembered.
Life was kind of simple, just kind of basic, honest people telling honest things. You tell that to somebody today, as Billy Harmon would say, you get locked up.
he was like, very witty. So he loved draft beer and he would stand in the locker room and he would drink at the bar in boxer shorts, and he always had silk boxers, and they were always polka dots, and they had patterns. He's really funny. And he's standing there just barefoot in boxers. And so this one little guy comes in there, and he looks at Mr. Demaret, and he had a little beer belly. And he goes, "Wow, Mr. Demaret, you've got a little beer belly." And he goes, "Let me tell you something, son. I'm going to be in that box a long time. I'm going to be skinny in the box." And so, but he was very witty, and he was very approachable. And that's the thing they all had in common is you could go right up and talk to him. There was no pretense to him. They didn't have egos. They were just normal human beings that had excelled and had a talent beyond belief, but they were very approachable, very nice. My dad and Jimmy Demaret, Ben Hogan, they were all normal human beings that just happened to be world-class golfers.
Well, they taught you a thing or two, because the moment Billy and I met you in the lower locker room lounge area, just setting up for our poker game, you were very nice to us, and we appreciate that. I'm looking at this picture here, and you know, you talk about your dad's swing and you talk about Demaret's swing. You can almost see that pronounced here. Demaret's kind of got that follow through, and his legs are kind of tight, but your dad has that more kind of round. You could see he made a big turn to get to that big follow through, right?
That must have been taken earlier in your dad's career, because he's still holding the club. I think Demaret might have thrown his, though.
Yes, that's correct. And Mr. Demaret was a tap putter. My dad was a, they've had different putting, different driving. My dad hooked the ball. Demaret hit a little fade. But Demaret did his own thing. He didn't, you know, I don't think I ever got a lesson from him, ever. He just played. He didn't give swing lessons. He just said, "I just swing a heavy club." And that's how he practiced. He would swing it out in front of the pro shop all the time and then go play. He never hit a ball, really. I never saw him practice much.
Well, if you think about the old courses, Wingfoot's the best example of it. They didn't really have driving ranges.
So they were, you know, my dad and Mr. Demaret, they didn't practice. And I think Mr. Hogan was the first one that started practicing. But they were adaptive players. In other words, they just, the conditions, the weather, clubs, balls weren't that great. They just did what they had to get the job done. And my dad had a different swing. You know, he said almost every day, he said, "If the wind's blowing, I'm swinging different than it's not." So what they taught us is to be imaginative and don't be afraid to make a change. A lot of guys get fixated on a swing plane and this just, and then they get off their rails and they can't get it back. My dad would change swings in the middle of a round if he wasn't hitting it good. So he wasn't afraid to make a change. He wasn't afraid to change. And that way, when you're playing bad, it doesn't shock you. And then you figure out a way to get better during the round.
Get the ball in the hole.
Yes.
So we sometimes do this exercise. You're in one of these meetups and there's three people in one part over in this side of the room is one person. In the back of the room is another person. Over here is another person. Ben Hogan, we're going to leave your dad out because I think you'd go spend time with your dad if you had the opportunity. Every set, just like Billy would do that with his dad, or I would do that with my dad. But the three people are Hogan's over here on the left, Arnold Palmer's in the back of the room, and Demaret's in there. And you get to go, and you can only visit with one person. Who are you going to go spend 20 minutes with?
Jimmy Demaret.
That says a lot.
That's incredible.
No, he was my grandfather's, Jack Burke Sr., that was his guy.
That says a lot.
Remember seeing him on The Wonderful World of Golf in the mid-60s and beyond, mm-hmm. and always thinking that this guy's got a lot of charm and a lot of charisma.
Yes.
And then you see him on the Lucy clip, and it you know, mm-hmm. he gets right the into other thing, it as if he's a professional.
The other thing is, he was a really smart, very intelligent investor. He did really well in the real estate business. He was a great landman. He completely understood the capital markets and the stock market, because I was his stockbroker until he died. And, you know, his family still has the Demaret estate in my office. So, but, and I talked to him, he loved the stock market and he loved investing, whether it was real estate or stocks or bonds or whatever. But he was a very well-read, intelligent man. He was very intelligent. And I learned a lot from him about investing because he was so patient. You know, he wasn't in a hurry.
That's the answer to a lot of questions in life is patience.
Yes. Yes, and he didn't have an ego at all. He never talked about himself, really. And my dad doesn't talk. That's what the great men are, men that they're not self-absorbed. And they've told me this many times, there's two people in life. You know, there's givers and there's takers. And these gentlemen were all givers. And the givers have all the happiness. They have all the wealth. They have all the friends. And they live a good life.
It's sort of nostalgic to hear these stories about these great people from back in the day. And I guess the past always looks nostalgic to people. But today you can sort of see some of that forming with guys like, Ricky Fowler out there and Palmer before him. It's wonderful when you see those guys. They stand out to me. And again, they don't know how great they are, which is what makes them so great. That's a great point you made, Mike, and I appreciate hearing it from you.
Thank you. I love Wingfoot, by the way.
What's your favorite hole at Wingfoot?
Number 10.
10 West?
Absolutely.
Where you won the playoff this year in the
end. That's right. That's right.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Mike.
Made better because of this hour we spent with you. Thanks so much.
Well, you gentlemen are wonderful, and I look forward to seeing you next June.
Come back and play with us.
So you wouldn't care. You wouldn't care if all your members threw a few clubs down there.
No, they will go get them.
So your dad and you'd fit. What do you feel it in your legs?
I feel it in my. I went to my right leg, and now it's like I threw this head. Like this head was gonna come off. I'm gonna throw this club head. I'm gonna throw this club head out.
Thanks for joining us today,
Billy Harmon.
We really appreciate your
double
feedback.
Double Indemnity.
And please. Barkey. Subscribe to the show and hit the bell icon so you get notified.
Movie classics.
New episodes.
Mark Gable.
Hit 'em hard. And hit 'em off.
Best 36 holes.